I want you to turn to your partners and share what examples of personification that you can think of in the books that you've read, either in the classroom or on your own.
Look at
the movie.
Thanks, Carol.
Sure. Okay, begin. Talk to your partner. You can also think of Harry Potter. What was personified in Harry Potter? What characters do we know about that have disliked human qualities? Okay, I would like to know, what are some of your ideas, Reagan?
The pictures in Harry Potter.
The pictures in Harry Potter, they move, right? They move and they talk. Can pictures actually move and talk?
Yes.
No, they cannot. So the pictures have been personified by the author. Vanya.
The chocolate frogs,
yes. Can chocolate hop?
No.
Yes.
No. But can people hop?
Yes.
Yeah, so they personify the chocolate frog. Bruce? Rooms? Not so much because people can't fly.
Why though? Bruce.
Catherine.
I have a question. Does it have to be from here?
No. Any book? Yes.
I have a nonfiction animal and a nonfiction talking.
Okay, what is it?
It could be a Pegasus talking.
Pegasus talking, okay, Leilani.
Is that Dobby?
Dobby, yes. He is an elf which doesn't exist, but he does display some human characteristics. So that could be an example of personification. Okay, I'm going to show you an example of personification. Oh, this was where have we seen personification before? And this guy has a thinking cap on. Because he's thinking. And then he's amazed, Rorati, he's amazed. That was a vocabulary word we've had.
Wait.
About whatever he's thinking, so he goes, wow. Yes.
That's like from Back to the Future.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So here are a couple examples. What's personified here? You can yell it out.
The hat.
The sorting hat. Raise your hand and tell me how the sorting hat is personified in the Harry Potter series, Sapphire.
He talks.
He sorts them, right? Can hats talk and sort people?
Wait.
No, but can't people sort and talk? Yeah. I'm not going to call on you if people like this. Don't be a Hermione. Cat in the Hat. Is he personified?
Yeah.
What does he do?
He talks.
Harry Potter, I don't want you to shout out. Jacob, what does the cat do? He talks and he walks standing up. Like, he doesn't walk on all fours like a regular cat. He walks standing up. The little engine that could. The little engine has a face. And he tries really hard to get up there and he goes, I think I can. Can trains do that? Can people do that? Yes. Okay, here's a book that we read in class. Martina, the Beautiful Cockroach. What does Martina do? Jacob?
She talks.
She doesn't walk like a real cockroach. She walks like a human. What else does she do? What's the main part of the story? Yes.
Is that she could drink coffee, but cockroaches can't. And plus, they don't even know, and then, to pour enough. Because usually cups are super big. Cockroaches are super big.
All right, what else does she, what is she looking for? What's the whole point of the story, Manya?
Another characteristic about her from swimming is that she's beautiful and cockroaches are, like, disgusting.
Okay, she's beautiful, and she looks for a... starts with an H.
Husband.
She looks for a husband.
Wait.
I'm pretty sure that cockroaches don't have husbands and wives?
Yes, they do.
I mean, it could be possible, but humans definitely do have husbands and wives. Okay, and then over here, we just read about this in Harry Potter. What is that tree?
The Whomping Willow.
The Whomping Willow, and what is he doing? He's attacking the car. He's crushing him. Trees can't really do that unless they fall on accident and the car just happens to be underneath it. But humans can attack cars, in theory. Okay, and then the talking candlesticks and pots and clocks from Beauty and the Beast. And then Shrek's down there, the donkey talks. And then this little guy, he is from Harry Potter. Where do we see him?
The first one.
Right here? Jonathan? No. Close. Amitai?
In the zoo?
Yes, in the zoo. He talks to Harry.
In the immigrant.
Okay. Now, I would like you now to read some of these sentences. Talk to your partners and discuss what object is being personified and what are they doing that makes them a personified object. All right? So talk with your partners. I'll give you about 3 minutes. Do you have questions? The centaur. One more minute. Talk to your partners.
Oh.
A brim, like the brim of a hat, and a rip, like it's ripped. Brim of a hat. Okie dokie. So I am going to call on some people, and you are going to tell me what object is being personified and what human characteristic they are displaying. So Uriel, what is being personified in number one? What object has human qualities? The hat, exactly. So I'm going to circle hat right here. And what is he doing that makes him kind of like a human? Yes. Singing. Yeah, he's singing. Very good, Ariel. Thank you. Number two, Jonathan. The tree. The tree is the subject that's being personified. What is he doing?
Attacking
them. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Next one, Kevin. What's being personified? The snake, yes. And what is he doing that makes him human-like? What is he doing? Close. He winked, right? That word's wink. It's not walking. It looks similar, but it's... He winked. Okay, number four. Number four. Anthony, what's being personified here? What's the object? What's the subject of the sentence? The flame, yes. The flame from the candle. And what is it doing that makes it like a human? Yes, it danced. It danced in the dark. Very nice. Number five, angel. Sunflowers nodded freely in the wind. What's the object? What is it? What is the main object that's being personified here? Yes, sunflowers. And what is it doing that makes it like a human? Help him out. Someone help him out. Catherine.
Nodded.
Nodded. It nodded freely in the wind. Can sunflowers nod?
Yes.
No.
They can't go up and down like this, right? But they can. But humans can. Okay. Number six, the last slice of pizza was calling my name, Daniel.
Pizza.
Pizza. Or you could also say slice. What's calling my name? Vanya. What makes a human like? What is it doing? Calling. Can pizza yell, hey, Miss B, hey, Miss B?
No.
No, but can people yell, hey, Miss B? Yes.
Yes.
Two more. Leilani. Number seven.
The sun?
Sun. And what is it doing?
Greeted
everyone. Perfect. Last one. Reagan. The heart. My heart. And what is it doing? That makes it like a human.
Jumping.
The heart was jumping out of my chest.
You know that when plants are drying, they lose water. Like they lose their water and like let it like go out of them, and that makes the plant like freeze backwards and scared.
Okay, that's a kind of a real life example of personification. Okie dokie. So thumbs up if you're understanding this. Everybody I called on said exactly the right thing. Layla, put that away now. Do not roll your eyes at me. That is not okay. All right. So, the next thing we're going to do is I'm going to pass out a copy of The Wizard and the Hopping Cup, and you are going to follow along as I read. And as I read, I would like you to highlight or underline some examples of personification that you notice. So, if you see something being personified. Yes. Please underline or circle it or highlight it. Everybody needs to be ready in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, and one. Okay. The Wizard and the Hopping Pot. Everyone's eyes need to be on the first. Grab a pen and a pencil. Okay. There once was a kindly old wizard who used his magic generously. I'm going to start over because I was reading talking. There once was a kindly old wizard who used his magic generously and wisely for the benefit of his neighbors. Rather than reveal the true source of his power, he pretended that his potions, charms, and antidotes sprang ready-made from the little cauldron he called his lucky cooking pot. From miles around, people came to him with their troubles, and the wizard was pleased to give the pot a stir and put things right. This well-beloved wizard lived to a goodly age, then died, leaving all of his chattels to his only son. This son was of a very different disposition to his gentle father. Those who could not work magic were, to the son's mind, worthless, and he had often quarreled with his father's habit of dispensing magical aid to their neighbors. Upon the father's death, The son found hidden inside the old cooking pot a small package bearing his name. He opened it, hoping for gold, but found instead a soft, thick slipper, much too small to wear, and with no hair. A fragment of parchment within the slipper bore the words, "In the fond hope, my son, that you will never need it." The son cursed his father's age-softened mind, then threw the slipper back into the cauldron, resolving to use it henceforth as a rubbish can. That very night, the peasant woman knocked on the front door. "My granddaughter is afflicted by a crop of warts, sir," she told him. "Your father used to mix a special poultice in that old cooking pot." "Be gone," cried the son. "What care I for your brat's warts?" And he slammed the door on the old woman's face. At once there came a loud clanging and banging from his kitchen. The wizard lit his wand and opened the door, and there, to his amazement, he saw his father's old cooking pot. It had sprouted a single foot of grass and was hopping on the spot in the middle of the floor, making a fearful noise upon the flagstones. The wizard approached it in wonder, but fell back hurriedly when he saw that the whole of the pot surface was covered in warts. "Disgusting object," he cried, and he tried firstly to manage the pot, then to clean it by magic, and finally to force it out of the house. None of his spells worked, however, and he was unable to prevent the pot from hopping after him out of the kitchen and following him up to bed, clanging and banging loudly on every wooden stair. The wizard could not sleep all night for the banging of the warty old pot by his bedside, and next morning the pot insisted upon hopping after him to the breakfast table. Clang, clang, clang went the brass-footed pot, and the wizard had not even started his porridge when there came another knock on the door. An old man stood on the doorstep. "'Tis my donkey, sir," he exclaimed. "Lost she is, or stolen. Without her, I cannot take my wares to market, and my family will go hungry tonight." "And I am hungry now," roared the wizard. He slammed the door upon the old man. Clang, clang, clang went the cooking pot. Single brass foot upon the floor. But now its clamor was mixed with the brays of a donkey and human groans of hunger echoing from the depths of the pot. "Be silent, be still," shrieked the wizard. But not all his magical powers could quiet the warty pot, which hopped after his heels all day, braying and groaning and clanging no matter where he went or what he did. That evening there came a third knock upon the door, and there on the threshold stood a young woman sobbing as though her heart would break. "My baby is grievously ill," she said. "Won't you please help us? Your father bade me to come if troubled." But the wizard slammed the door on her. And now the tormenting pot filled to the brim with salt water and slopped tears all over the floor as it hopped and brayed and groaned and sprouted more warts. Though no more villagers came to seek help at the wizard's cottage for the rest of the week, the pot kept him informed of their many ills. Within a few days, it was not only braying and groaning and slopping and hopping and sprouting warts, it was also choking and retching, crying like a baby, whining like a dog, and spewing out bad cheese and sour milk in a plague of hungry slugs. The wizard could not sleep or eat with the pot beside him, but the pot refused to leave, and he could not silence it or force it to be still. Refused is one of our vocabulary words. At last, the wizard could bear it no more. "Bring me all of your problems, all of your troubles, and all of your woes," he screamed, fleeing into the night, with the pot hopping behind him along the road into the village. "Come, let me cure you, mend you, and comfort you. I have my father's cooking pot, and I shall make you well." And with the foul pot still bounding along behind him, he ran up the street, casting spells in every direction. Inside one house, the little girl's warts vanished as she slept. The lost donkey was summoned from a distant briar patch and set down softly in its stable. The sick baby was doused in dittany and woke well and rosy. At every house of sickness and sorrow, the wizard did his best, and gradually the cooking pot beside him stopped groaning and retching and became quiet, shiny, and clean. "Well, pot?" asked the troubled wizard as the sun began to rise. The pot burped out a single slipper he had thrown onto it and permitted him to fit it on the brass foot. Together, together, they set off back to the wizard's house, and the pot's footstep muffled at last. But from that day forward, the wizard helped the villagers, like his father before him, lest the pot cast off its slipper and begin to hop.